Do you want it rolling as soon as he answers?
Yeah. I'm like, all I want is a glass of wine. Girl, you're working with some flash, yeah. Your bae, yeah. Make a fella spend the cash, yeah. His bag, yeah. Girl, you're working with some flash, yeah. Your bae, yeah. Make a fella spend the bag, yeah. His cash, yeah. Girl, you made it, you made it. Oh, yeah, you made it, you made it. Baby, girl, you made it, you made it. Oh, yeah, you made it, you made it. Been a long time coming. Okay, hi. How are we? Thank you for taking the time out of your Sunday. I do have an intro for you, so you're gonna have to sit and take like a couple accolade compliments.
Oh, I can't wait to hear this. You know, somebody, I was really bad at taking compliments until, I'm pretty sure it might've been Blythe maybe, I can't remember who it was, but they said, the only thing you have to do when you take a compliment is just say thank you, that's it.
Exactly, so you're gonna and she's funny, because when I interviewed her, I said the same thing, and she was like, the whole time I just wanted to interrupt you. So, okay, here we go, intro. And you're a words guy, so me writing this, I was like, this has got to be good. So, artist, songwriter, California native, whose Instagram bio states himself as just your resident country music goth, Devin Dawson continues to make a mark in the music world by mastering melodies without ever losing the substance and intention of the story he tells within each line. His hit single, All On Me, reached top 20 on the Hot Country Songs and peaked at number 2 on Billboard's Country Airplay charts. His collaborative journey includes songs as a writer, credited as a writer as God's Country by Blake Shelton, and most recently received his first ever number one single with One Beer by Hardy featuring Lauren Alaina, a now 2-time ACM nominee as of literally Friday. Yeah. Woo! Devin heads into the next evolution of his sound with his recently released EP called The Pink Slip. He's a meticulous wordsmith who continues to pave a path all his own by not only focusing on how each song sounds, but the importance of how they feel. I'm so excited and honored to have you join me for this episode today. Thank you for showing up as you are, Devin Dawson. Let's go.
I need to write all my bios from now on.
I was going to say, I could just send that to you if you want.
Very eloquent. I just got to make sure I credit you at the end.
Perfect. Well, I'm happy that you liked it. That approval is... very nice.
Both wearing some vintage big ass t-shirts too. I got my old Garth Brooks t-shirt on.
Okay, so I was like, oh, I love that. I was like, I could wear all black or I rock like the band tee, so.
Charcoal gray action, we like it. We're here for it.
Since the release of your first album, I feel like so much has happened for you and it's been nonstop. Go, go, go. So this past year, how have you handled slowing down?
I think the biggest thing is just like being able to justify rest. I think for me, it's always been really hard to like, I know there's importance and value in resting, and especially as a creative person, like replenishing your juices or whatever you want to call it. But I think when we're all in the, you know, fast track of just go, 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 accomplish, 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 all that stuff. I think it's hard to let yourself have a day to rest or an hour or whatever, especially when you're just so competitive against, like, you know, well, somebody else is writing a song right now, somebody else is recording, somebody else is on the road, you know?
Yeah.
And so that was something that was always hard for me. And I have seen the fruits of the labor or the fruits of, you know, not working and all that stuff. So it's like, I know that it's important to rest, but I think this year like forced me to do it. And like, it was never like, you know, no one can tour, no one can do these things. And so it was like, I'm not missing out on things that other people are doing. And so I think it helped me like mentally to just know that, like, you know what, I have no other choice but to just sit back and use this time to rest and, you know, kind of regroup on my creative point of view and all that stuff. So it's definitely been a good year. I've had a really good year, like, as far as, like you said, like writing other songs for like Blake Shelton and other things like that. And so it's kind of been weird because I do feel like this weird kind of survivor's guilt for like still like being stable this year, like I guess financially or whatever. So that's kind of been a weird thing to like just see so many people not being okay and me like still somehow like, you know,
sustaining,
being able to feed myself and still have a house and still be in good graces and stuff like that. But
I've had a really good year.
That's good. That's nice to hear. And I was going to ask you too. I feel like you are someone that, from what I know, you do just enjoy writing to write. Do you like journaling and stuff like that? Do you find now, even with this time, did you ever like have that time to just write for you rather with the intention of like a song? Do you still do that? Are you able to still do that?
Yeah.
And sometimes you write a song, like when you're saying, sometimes when people say, are you writing for you? Meaning like, am I going to cut this song? But I think what you mean is just writing for my own personal, like, it's like regardless of if it comes out or not. And yeah, I've definitely written a handful of those songs that I wrote by myself for whatever reason. I just needed to get it out. And, you know, whether that's going to make it on a major label country album, I'm probably not going to happen. But, you know, it's really cool to see these songs come out and inform the next song that might be a little bit more commercial or whatever. And it's definitely like, I've kind of always like built these songs up that like one day I want to put out an album of songs that I've written by myself or things that were, you know, too big or too good of a, too crazy of a concept for the normal person to understand on a first listen or whatever. Yeah. Like sometimes finding that balance commercially is like really important, but I'm really fulfilled and like I get my rocks off by doing something I've never done before or that's never been heard or never been said. And sometimes those ideas or concepts are just too big for people sometimes other than me, but one day I'm going to put out an album of all of those just cathartically to just be like, yo, this is what I do when I don't have anyone else around. This is what happens, what comes out, you know?
When working on album two, so for me, I've always thought, and you could attest to it or not, but I've always felt like, so you had such a huge introduction to the with your first album, right? With Dark Horse and just like that success that it brought you. But working on album two, do you feel like that's more intimidating and like, do you feel more?
100%.
You do, right? Because to me, I've always thought like as an artist, like, okay, this is my introduction, but now where do I go from here? So I was wondering when you've been working on your second album, what did you intentionally do this time differently?
I think having success actually isn't the part that's intimidating. I think it's like having things that weren't as successful as other endeavors. You know what I mean? That makes it intimidating because then you're like, well, like I need to find that balance and make sure I have enough. I need to have a couple radio songs and then I need to have a couple songs for my fans. Then I need to have a couple songs for me and stuff like that. And sometimes you don't get enough like real estate to do all of that. You know what I mean? And so it's just about like finding that balance. Like, you know, the beginning of my first album, Dark Horse, was like all on me and that became a hit. And then we put out a second single called Ask Him for a Friend, which is one of my favorite songs. And it was something that the label thought was like a shoe-in, just absolutely no-brainer. This is what we're doing, second single, keep the momentum going. And it ended up like not even charting for whatever reason. There's a million things you could go into. But I think it was like it was hard for me to like be so in love with a song and see it not be like accepted in the same way that a song had been before for me, you know? And so, and then after that, you know, you usually only get three singles for your album sort of thing, unless you're just like rocking. And for a new artist, it's really hard to get more than two or three on an album just because of how long it takes to get up the charts and stuff. And so it was like, well, I get one more chance and I'm going to put out Dark Horse as a single because to me, that's just my introduction to the world. And it's something that my fans love. And it was kind of this, like, I don't give a fuck, whatever happens kind of like decision. And I knew that it wasn't going to be like the smash single of the summer, but I still wanted to make it a single just to be like, yo, this is what I do. This is where I'm putting my flag. And, you know, and so, but again, that one didn't have radio success as much as All on Me. And so it was kind of this, like, this thing of like, yo, like I did have a lot of success with All on Me, even though, like you said, it didn't go number one. And so that was a little bit heartbreaking. Like we missed number one by like one spin or something crazy like that.
Yeah.
But it's like, how can I complain about having a hit song that went all the way to number two on my first try? So it's like this weird dichotomy of like, there's a lot of stuff to be happy about, but like, I want to make sure that I'm still finding the balance. And I'm just a really competitive guy. Like, and I think comparing is not good, but I think competitiveness is okay, you know?
Yeah.
And so I want to win everywhere. I want to win in movies. I want to win on TV. I want to win live. I want to win in the radio. I want to win in the cred department. I want to win in the deep cuts. I want to win everywhere, you know? And so just trying to put a project together after Dark Horse that had all of that, was the goal. And then I think just the pressure of like having success with songs and then not having success with other songs and like really needing to get back into that. Like sometimes that pressure just is really hard. And when you're a creative, like it's one thing, like you need to always like rise to the occasion and you know, do something awesome within that pressure. But sometimes it's just really hard to create like very personally or whatever with that pressure in mind. And the process took a lot longer than I wanted it to, but I'm stoked to be like on the other side of it now, right, I guess. Right. I don't know
if, I feel like a lot of people do know this, maybe they don't, but starting out as a songwriter and then coming into kind of this art, well, you started out actually, you played heavy, like death, like intense metal band as a bassist. Yeah. Yeah. And then coming to Nashville, being a songwriter, I've always wondered, you know, how with like Maren Morris, My Church, that was a song for her where she was like, I can't picture anyone else singing this. Julia Michaels, Issues, I can't picture anyone else singing this. Taking that kind of transformation, that leap from songwriter to artist. Did you have a moment like that for you?
Yeah, I mean, yeah, 100%. I mean, I think that's like a lot of the process or the journey of a lot of artists, you know? I mean, there's a lot of different kinds of artists, but like, there's nothing wrong with being an artist that cuts other people's songs because I write for them too. Like, I love that people want to record my songs, but, and I'm not against recording something that I didn't write if it says it in the way that I would or better than I could do it on my own or whatever. I just haven't done that yet, really. But yeah, I mean, I think either Dark Horse or All On Me was definitely something where I was like, because All On Me, when I wrote it, like, I just knew it was a hit. You know what I mean? And so it, you know, a lot of my publishers, you know, sometimes your publisher who is on the songwriting side is just there to serve their own world in publishing. And so they're like, I know you want to hold on to this, but we could get a Rascal Flatts cut or we could get this cut. And I'm like, well, that sounds awesome, but you got to put investment in yourself as an artist. And that's been something I've learned a lot is like, even though it, you know, it might take 2 years for me to record this song and I can get a cut in a week, it's like, you know, if the song becomes a hit and it puts my career in a place, you know, that a hit song can, it's like, I could make as much in one night as I make on the entire song. Like as an artist, I can make as much in one night as I would in a song as a songwriter, if that makes sense, you know.
Yeah.
So I just think seeing those things in action definitely helped me realize that, as much as I like really love the idea of having other people record my songs. But All On Me was something I heard and I was just like, man, I feel like it's a hit. It sounds like a hit. Like, I want to do this, you know what I mean? And so that, and then Dark Horse, you know, no one else is going to sing Dark Horse because it's literally about specific things in my life that I deal with or that I believe in or whatever. And so it's been cool to see that become widely relatable. And it's taught me that, like, as much as you think that you need to be broad and like overarching to get to everyone, I think the opposite is true. It's like when you're very specific and you're very like, just like, you know, saying exact specific examples of things that you go through, I think other people can relate to that, because when they hear it and it's like, wow, I'm going through the exact same thing, it kind of becomes more relatable than just the blanket statement. You know what I mean?
Yeah, I love that. And even bouncing off of that, I feel like in country, sometimes artists could just go with like the beer, the partying, like it depends, right? Artists in general have fun. You could be as in depth or as like across the board fun, lighthearted as you want it to be. But I feel like you're always intentional and you do go deeper. And I wonder, has vulnerability always been something that you view as a strength in general in your life and like in writing? Like, what is that like for you, especially as a male in country music? I'm just stereotyping for the topic of the question. Yeah. But I think a lot of times it's refreshing to hear guys put their heart on their sleeve and really go there. And I feel like you do that intentionally. And
that's the shit I love. I mean, and I do it because of music. Like, I'm not necessarily vulnerable, like sitting down in a conversation, but like when I'm hiding behind my guitar or whatever, like I can say whatever the fuck I want. And like, yeah, it makes me feel good to say things that I wouldn't say in a different situation, for whatever reason, you know what I mean? And so I like to lean into that. And again, sometimes it doesn't need to be so deep. Sometimes just a fun, lighthearted song is awesome. But I identify more with the more vulnerable kind of things that are like heartfelt and maybe something that you hadn't heard in that way before, but you're like, everyone can kind of relate to.
Yeah.
Those are the things that when I'm listening or when I'm writing that just like stir me. You know what I mean?
It's refreshing. I think it's important. That's like the connect. And I feel like we are drawn to artists, and you probably are drawn to artists that do the same thing and feel that vulnerability. I think too, the song He Loved Her that you recently released, an ode, a love letter to your grandparents' love story, was so beautiful. And what was that experience like for you writing that, inspiration-wise, going back home, filming the video, having your grandfather in the video? Can you talk a little bit about that as well?
Yeah, I mean, that's a song that is very simple. And like for me, when I first wrote it, I almost thought it was too simple for me, and it didn't have like an extra like under the water iceberg thing that I usually love, you know. And it didn't challenge people as much as I love to challenge them. But I think that's why it was so good, because it is different for me to do something so simple. And it was something my dad was like, man, like, this is the most simple, like right down the middle, like right at it country song you've ever written. And I think that you need to do that every once in a while, because as much as you love to have a crazy huge concept, it's like not everybody's in that mood all the time. You know what I mean? So, yeah, we wrote it. It's funny. It started out as a song that I wanted to write, like what I would put on my tombstone when I died. And like the co-writers were like, I mean, that's a little morbid. Maybe we like turn it into something a little sweeter. And so one of them was just like, what would you put on your tombstone? And the first thing I said was like, he loved her. Like, if they were like, if you had three words, what would you put? And I was like,
wow,
he loved her. And she's like, well, that sounds like a song, you know? Yeah. So we wrote the whole song. We wrote half of the song and then scrapped the entire thing because it wasn't good enough. It was like, we wrote it in a sense of like this relationship where like, you know, it was kind of this like, aw shucks, bless her heart kind of thing, where it was like the girl, you know, she wanted him to paint the house pink. And so he went out and he did the whole thing. And right when he finished the last board, she told him it was the wrong shade. And so he started again. It's like, he did it cause he loved her. And she would cook breakfast every morning, and even though she burnt the eggs, he would still eat it, and without saying anything, like that kind of stuff. Yeah. And it was like, yeah, he loves her, and it was cool, but I didn't like the girl. Like, it started to become to a point where I was like annoyed by her, you know?
Yeah.
So I'm like really conscious of making sure, like most of the time, that like I like both characters. Like if it's a breakup song, like if it's not the guy's fault, if it's not the singer's fault, like I want to make sure that like no one hates the girl, like unless that's the point of it. But anyways,
that's so interesting.
So we like stopped, and I was like, I just don't think it's right yet. We gotta start over, which is one of the like very few, less than five times I've ever done that. And it's really hard to start a song over once you've already like been tainted by what it was, you know what I mean? And like forgetting all that. And then I just thought about my grandpa and like, you know, how he's my rock, and I've learned so much from him, and I would die to be half the man he is, you know? And so kind of just thinking about that, and then thinking about how cool it was to do a song that's like inspired by rather than in memory of, because he's still around, you know? So it was cool to get a chance to share that with him rather than like an afterthought, you know what I mean?
When did you play it for him for the first time?
I think I sent them, I did a lyric video where I like asked them to send me a bunch of like,
I saw that old photo, like photo, yeah, photo album.
It's like the simplest lyric video I've ever done, but it was like the best one. And it just, I put a photo album together of old photos, and then I just wrote the lyrics. And then the whole video was me literally just turning the pages. It was super, super easy, but it just like really served the song really well. And
yeah,
I sent them that, and they were just like, they loved it. And then I was like, if I come home for Thanksgiving, are you guys down to like just hang out and film it? And like, I've had the same video guy for like 3 years, 4 years. And so they know Tyler really well. So it was just super comfy. And there was no like plot, there was no makeup, there was no bullshit. It was just me hanging out at my house with my grandpa like I normally would at any other time. And so it was really easy and really simple, just like the song was. But it was a cool moment to get to kind of put into stone. You know what I mean?
Yeah. No, I love the video. I watched it the other day and I was like, this is so beautiful and simplistic, and it doesn't try too hard. Cause I think too, sometimes with songwriting, that there can be that those moments of overwriting where I've seen it with people.
I'm the king of that.
Really? But do you do that as like an exercise, or do you do that like on purpose? Like, is it something that do you see how far you can go with
It's not because I want to see how far I can go. It's because my brain tells me more. Yeah. And then I listen the next morning, I'm like, oh, we don't need that bridge or that verse. And it's like, it's better to have more and cut it down. You know what I mean? And
then
afterwards, like, I think just going with the flow and staying in the flow state of creativity and let it all come out and whatever happens, happens, and then let it have space for a day and then come back and listen to it. And like, what would you do? Or sometimes I try to like sing it like as if I was remembering it without listening to it. And then I'll record that. And then like, there'll be little melodies or little word changes that I just didn't even realize I did that just feel natural because I wasn't so fucking close to it. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
And so, yeah, I don't write lyrics down. I just like, if I don't remember it, then it's not good enough. You know what I mean? Like, so
yeah,
I don't know. It's just, you know, that kind of thing.
I've always thought you were a really smart songwriter, smart artist in terms of songwriting, because you do have fun with melodies. Like one of my favorite songs, I don't know if you know this, is Dip. I will always love that song. It's very, because it has that groove, but you're still smart with your lyrics, which I always appreciate. And you do that very beautifully, where like you can have a fun groove and a fun melody, but there's so much depth there. And you're like, oh, he's smart. He like knows what he's saying.
Yeah, it kind of breaks my heart that like, melody is really the only thing that people like remember sometimes, at least on first listen, or like, God, yeah, what's that song? The teenage dream. Oh, that's yeah. What it is. You know what I mean? You kind of like,
yeah. Wait.
But I think melodies will draw you in, and groove will kind of draw you in. But if there's not something to come back to dive into, like, I won't listen again. You know what I mean? Like,
right.
And a lot of times the songs that I don't like at first are songs that I'm like obsessed with now, because it just took me a second to like really understand what was being said or what the moves were or whatever. And it, you know, melody kind of draws you in, but lyrics keep you coming back. And I want my music to kind of never get old, you know?
I love that. You've been performing, writing, being part of music for so long, for so many years, I feel like. So, and you've used the word, even in this conversation, challenge. You like to challenge yourself. How do you do that? How do you keep things new? Like what part of you in the process, maybe in just life in general, how do you challenge yourself? How do you keep things interesting and not feel like jaded, especially in a town like Nashville where everyone's doing the same thing, right? So how does Devin Dawson continue to step out of his comfort zone? What does that look like?
Just being okay with doing what you think is cool. Like, it could be wrong, and it's just in terms of the masses, but like, if you don't follow your gut, then like, what the fuck are you here for? Like, you gotta do just what feels cool to you, you know? And I think the balance is important, especially like, it just all is kind of informed by what your goals are. Like, I am a major label country artist, you know, I have the opportunity to put out country music and like, you know, have it be heard across the world and go see fans and make a living doing that. You know what I mean? So like, I do think about that, even though I have been in a death metal band and I love pop music and I love R&B and I love all these things. Like, it's like, I'm here in Nashville doing country music, and that's a huge part of my sound as well. And so sometimes I like recently I've just been writing so many, just like, so country songs. And like, for me, I think people love what I do in this genre because it is a little bit of an outlying kind of left-handed thing. But I always do stuff that I think is going to be unexpected. Like, I don't think people would expect me to put out like a very, very country like album, you know what I mean? And so right. Like, on my next stuff that I'm starting right now, I'm just like, for some reason, I'm just like really liking like very country things. And I think God's Country kind of helped me like open up my mind to that side of myself, even though it was always a side of myself. I think I liked to be different and do something unexpected within the genre. But I think leaning into that super country side of what I do like is unexpected for people at this point now. And so maybe that's why I'm liking it. It's just, I don't know. I just try to do unexpected stuff. And that's the stuff that like I said, that's the stuff that excites me, is like things that I'm like, wow, I never heard that before.
Yeah,
that's cool. Like, I don't know, I just, maybe it's because I'm Aquarius, maybe it's because I'm a twin, I don't fucking know.
Your version of God's Country, you could tell when you're singing it that you're like owning it. There's like that grit. God's Country is such a smash. I don't even listen to like Heart and Soul country as much as I feel like maybe I did in the past now, but listening to that song in a car,
that's the perfect example of like, yeah, God's Country is a country song, but it's like, it's the perfect balance between heavy, like visceral sounding like metal almost,
yeah,
but with like the heart of like the pride that we all have.
Yeah,
so it was like the perfect balance of commerciality and something that was different. And like, it's just really hard to get the recipe right sometimes,
right?
But that song, like, you know, I wasn't really ever going to record that. And I think I wrote it with Hardy. And so he was going to do it before I did, because he kind of sang the demo and it kind of went towards him.
Right.
But afterwards I was like, well, I'll do my own version of it. And it, like, I don't know, I'm very lucky to have the license in my own mind to pursue a lot of different types of sonic identities, I guess, within this genre. So I just try to lean into that, just because it makes me feel good, you know?
For sure. And with the Pink Slip EP, you've said, I've never put anything out so inspirational slash hopeful.
Yeah.
What do you mean by that? Also, I obviously listened to the EP. It's so fun. And like, that's, I feel like, definitely a cool evolution of your sound too, production-wise. I could be wrong.
Not what I would expect, or maybe what my fans would expect. Yeah, I don't know. It's just, you know, it's indicative of just what I've gone through in the last couple of years, whether it's finding success or falling in love and getting married and having a house and seeing the world and all these things that I dreamed of doing, you know, that when I was writing the first album, I didn't have any of that, you know? So, you know, my job, or our job as an artist, is to just tell people what we do and what we've gone through and be ourselves. And, as much as people might've expected me to lean into like more of the heartbreak, darker side of things, it's like, that's not what I was going through. And so I wanted to take a shot to at least, kind of showcase how happy I was and how much it was kind of hard for me to make sense of that.
What are you most excited about in the future? Like, with, hopefully, I'm sure you miss touring so much and just being like on stage.
I do, I definitely miss that. There's been a time where I'm like, I'm glad I didn't have to do that for a while, because I was just on the road for 4 years and it just, you get burnt out and you just forget like how special it is, you know, just like anything else as humans in life. And so, definitely excited to get back out on the road and like feel what a feeling of being in front of somebody in the same airspace, like singing and sharing. Like, I watched, there's this band that I love called Wolfpack, and they're like this like crazy like musical super group. And they did a show in December of 2019 in Madison Square Garden. They sold it out and they like recorded the whole thing live, and it was like right before the pandemic. And like, but anyways, I listened to it. I watched it on YouTube yesterday. I just started fucking bawling. Cause I'm just like, yeah. I obviously love the music, but I was just like, yeah. God, like there's this huge fucking crowd of 20,000 people and like, they're just singing every word. And I'm like, I don't know why. It's just like, just started tearing up. And I was like, God, I missed this shit, you know? So definitely looking forward to that. Looking forward to putting the Pink Slip and Dark Horse like into a set list and that kind of stuff. But I just, a couple weeks ago, I just started recording some new stuff with my brother.
I was going to ask about that. I saw...
Yeah, I've worked with the same producer on Dark Horse and the Pink Slip. And as much as I loved, you know, working with him and what he did to kind of introduce me and sonically into this world, like we just weren't on the same page anymore. You know what I mean? And so it was just time for a change. And it's just time for me to like have more control over the reins of what I want to sound like and have more decisions and shit like that. And
it's special that you get
not that my brother will let me have the power to decide or anything, but yeah, I mean, Jacob and I have been working together, you know, playing music since we were 12. So, you know, it's been 20 years of playing music together now. And it's just feels easy and right to just start recording some stuff with him. So yeah, it's super exciting.
I'm so excited for you. And that's like really special too. I've also been fortunate enough to see the growth of your career and going from, like, I mean, I think the first time I saw you play was at Soulshine Pizza.
Oh my God.
I went to this true story. I went with, obviously it's a true story, but I was with Taylor Edwards. We went to go watch Emily Landis and you played the round. And then just to see you, I mean, I've gone to see you play anytime pretty much when I can, when you're in New York. And I wish, my heart goes out to all of the performers, because I feel like that's where you see your songs really live and come to life in
you don't know. I mean, you can have all these plays and you can see all these numbers. It's just, that's, you don't quantify it until you get in front of somebody, you know? And honestly, like, I'm a little biased, but I really, really think that, you know, the touring industry has kind of really gotten the short end of the stick. Obviously there's a lot of other people with a lot of bigger problems, but it's causing a lot of families and a lot of people their jobs and things that we just need to get back to it. I know we're in the home stretch and it's really opening up now, but it's just been really hard to see that. I'm just excited to get back out and work, you know.
All right, let's close out. I have three rapid fire questions for you.
All right, you got it.
And you can take as long as you want. If you're like, wait, what the hell does that mean?
I suck at rapid fire, so
it's more like emotional rapid fire. Like, it's like you have to reflect a little bit. So, in this season of my life, I want to embrace.
I want to embrace. I don't know. I just want to prioritize like the things that I want to do. You know what I mean? I think as an artist, sometimes you get so like worried about what other people want and like what's going to be successful and all that stuff. But I think, you know, I want to be, I thought of this morning and I really want to write this song, but I'd rather be remembered than be rich or whatever. You know what I mean? Like, I don't want to be just rich because I was, this is what I have to do to be successful. Like, that doesn't mean shit to me. You know what I mean? Like, I want to be remembered from doing something on my own that I, that individualistic Aquarius twin thing, you know what I mean? Like, that's the shit that I, you know, really dream about. And so just prioritizing the things that I want to do and that my North Star is telling me to do. Mm-hmm. That's definitely something I need to do.
Yeah. That's awesome. I love that. Remembered, not rich. So, yeah. So true. Kind of similar. I want to, regardless of any obstacle, I want to claim, like take hold of.
I don't know, like just my health, I guess. It's like, not that anybody else would own that, but I just, even I haven't owned that. You know what I mean? Like, been drinking a lot this year, you know, been, we're taking in a lot of California smoke and just like kind of resting. And so I think just getting back up and working a lot more and,
yeah,
you know, taking ownership of my health and not just physically, you know, mentally and prioritizing that over people pleasing, you know.
Last question. I will always choose to show up. Show up how?
Like, just for my wife and my marriage, you know what I mean? Like, I think, yeah, like, as an artist, you get so fucking, like, me, selfish. Like, I'm telling my story, I'm showing my, like, whatever, you know? And not that I don't ever forget to show up for my wife. It's not like I don't show up, but, like, she has dreams and she has things that she's doing as well. And so trying to be better at just, like, you know, it's not just my dream that I'm worrying about. Like, it's hers that I'm worrying about, too. So just always showing up for her dreams and what she wants to do is something that I'm always constantly making sure I'm doing. Like I said, it's not that I don't do it. I just think that sometimes I get caught up in my own rat wheel, you know what I mean? That I'm just so like, oh shit, like, you know, I am married as well. Like, this is my wife's dream. I need to make sure I'm working towards her stuff too, not just, and honestly, that like really helps give me perspective and like gives me a break from my own fucking head for a second, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
So yeah, just making sure I'm always, you know, there for her and making sure I'm pushing her and helping her in any way I can.
That's awesome. You can follow Devin on Instagram at ZDevin. Buy and stream the Pink Slip EP. You can watch, so me interviewing you, this is funny because you've been interviewing people. He has a YouTube, right. Yeah, a YouTube series, video interviews series.
I'm calling it a truck cast.
A truck cast, I'm sorry. A truck cast called Truck and a Story to Tell. He's interviews and in his truck, people, his friends.
Yeah, I've done like a bunch of my friends, and I did one with Leah a couple weeks ago and all that. And we honestly had a lot of really crazy plans to like have some really cool people on. Obviously, pandemic kind of doesn't allow that, getting in the same car as somebody. But we're gonna keep going. And the cool thing about that is that it doesn't, there's not an end to it. I can do that for the rest of my life if I wanted to, but also there's something that's really like comfortable and just super easy about riding around talking like in a car or a truck. It's like, that's the safe spot. You know what I mean? So it was just this really simple, stupid idea that just has turned out to be really cool. So
do you like interviewing? Cause this series, this YouTube channel that I'm doing is my first time interviewing people. And I feel like I've enjoyed it. I mean, there are definitely challenges, but have you liked having
it? I love it. Yeah, I do love it. I'm good at it. Like, I'm good at talking. I'm good at, like...
You're great at responses and talking.
I talk a lot, I know.
I love it. No, it's great.
I'm good at, like, challenging
people to, like, maybe put them in a hard place, like, to answer a question or, like, maybe, like, not just doing the fluff, you know what I mean, and getting a little deeper. And that's kind of what the series is about. It's, like, telling stories of, like, the hardships before the glory. In that moment, right, like when you wanted to give up but you didn't, it's like when you're growing your hair out and you're like, oh, I just want to shave my head, and then you didn't, And you got through that awkward stage and you're like, you're so stoked that you did, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
But yeah, I love it. And it's cool. I do love it, interviewing people and just having a conversation. And I find, and you can tell me if it's the same for you, but I find I get so much out of asking. Like, again, my whole life is talking about myself, and I just get so much more pleasure sometimes from asking other people to talk about themselves to me. And I always get so much out of it, you know?
I just think that conversations shift everything. I think about all the even personal revelations that I've had where I'm like, oh, when did that happen? Oh, when I was talking to someone about something that it came to me.
Out, man. Always.
Yeah.
Everything.
So you can watch that. Truck and a Story to Tell. Amazing. DevinDawsonMusic.com has all of his updates for everything. And I'm just super grateful that you took the time. I know we've known each other for a little bit, but I will never be tired of cheering you on and seeing your success, because it's well deserved. And
proud of you and you starting your channel and getting some dope people on and asking some hard questions that people want to hear, not just some bullshit. And so
being as we are, right, showing up as we are, and just like
I have one question for you before we go too.
Okay, let's do it.
What's on your coffee cup?
Oh, you will like this. Okay, so I've started this thing as of yesterday where I'm gonna write a quote on my cup. So this set today, it says, "People who avoid failure also avoid success."
That's good. Can I tell you my favorite quote?
Sure, let's hear it.
"Our failure to sound like our heroes has allowed us to sound like ourselves."
Wow, yep. I like that.
That's John Mayer.
John Mayer, you love John Mayer. I love John Mayer too.
Yeah, we got to cut this interview before we start talking about John Mayer, because like, we'll go on for hours.
But in all seriousness, appreciate you taking the time. I know you could be doing a million other things right now. So I'm grateful and rooting for you always.
Cheers.
Cheers. Bye, Dev. Take care. Bye.
How did that go? Loved it.
Girl, you're working with some flash, yeah. Get back, yeah. Make a fella spend the cash, yeah. His bag, yeah. Girl, you're working with some flash, yeah. Get back, yeah. Make a fella spend the bag, yeah. His cash.